Give me a little more juice. Just a little bit. Volume. Volume. There you go. And I said, welcome to the show.
Oh, yeah.
Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized.
Here it's gone. Not here again. Ridiculous.
It's the recognized symbol of excellence in KISS podcasting.
Idiots I associate with.
It's your buddy Andy, and as always, I'm joined by Nick and jolly old Chris. What's happening, guys? That much.
Yeah, not much, man.
I don't know. Well, record store day happened.
Record store day was last week, which
was fun.
Seems to be picking up steam every year, which I guess is good for someone, hopefully. For bands and stores, I'm hoping it's good for everyone.
I hope so.
I don't know. It seems like it's, you know, like I said, it's growing every year. There's more stuff coming out, more releases are coming out, and also lines forming around the building and down the street.
Record stores opening before 8 a.m.
How crazy on a Saturday.
That doesn't make any sense. That's
selling out.
That would be like a musician shop, like a Guitar Center opening like 7 or 8 in the morning.
It fucking opened. We had to, and when I worked there, we had our Saturday sales meeting at like fucking 8 in the morning. We
damn.
Had to be there.
That's surprising with... Just it, what time is the Guitar Center usually open? 10, 11?
On
like
Saturday,
that.
I remember we opened at 9 a.m.
Wow.
Damn, getting started early on a weekend.
What a motley crew that was. I mean,
the
guy down in the drum department, he'd be drinking Pepto straight out of the bottle.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I would assume
it reeked like a distillery in there. Well, we were just a bunch of fucking idiots.
I would assume most of you were in bands who were probably either playing out somewhere or watching someone.
Yeah, out late.
Out late, yeah.
Partying our balls off.
Right.
Yeah.
9 a.m. on a Saturday.
Yeah, and it was Saturday was mandatory work day. There were no days
switch.
Off given on Saturdays.
Yeah, can't call off Saturday.
No.
A blackout day, if you will.
Yeah, because it would get fucking busy in there.
A condition of employment.
It was.
It's a term I've heard in the last week.
Oh, great. That sounds good.
A condition of employment.
I don't even want to know. We'll discuss
that?
This offline.
Yeah. Yeah, so record store day. We're also hot off of Ace's birthday, so that was another
How
thing.
How old is he now?
66.
Wow.
66.
I thought he was older than that, to be honest
yeah.
with
so
you.
So Paul's the baby, right?
Yeah.
Of the group.
At least of the original four.
Yeah, that's
yeah, right.
I mean. Yeah.
Yes, he is.
He's Paul's what, 65?
Yeah.
Yep.
How much longer can they honestly keep doing it at the
I thought they were older, to be honest with you. I think they got
Well, Peter's 70, right? Isn't he 70 at this point?
Well, are we talking about Peter and Ace? Or were you talking about how long can they continue
well,
the group?
I guess I'm talking Gene and Paul specifically. How long can they keep doing it? It's
they don't seem to be
pretty,
letting up.
Pretty
I mean.
Incredible that they're still wearing, you know, the the platform boots. And
I mean, people have been saying that for 20 years.
It's
called
Creature's Cod Piece.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
Sure,
I don't know.
Sure Gene can use all the help he can get at his age. I mean, maybe his balls are sagging down, but, you know, the tool tends to shrink a little bit.
It's more for support these days. To fight gravity.
So 66 years.
Yeah.
Anti-gravitational cod piece. I hope we get one of those today.
Oh, you never
well,
know.
In that case, you pull a Leslie Nielsen and turn it upside down like the gargoyle he was hanging off of in the Naked Gun movie. Wait a minute. I thought you said this guy had the next few weeks off.
Well,
he's not happy.
Mm-mm.
He told me the other day he's not mm-hmm. happy that he has to keep doing this because the lip balm last week was such a hit.
Yeah.
that now there's like a demand for it
right.
for the next 3 weeks.
It became a sensation.
So he had to cancel the Shaved Rock trip with the family.
Oh, you know what that means. He's yet another victim of Jones Brothers bullshit.
It's a condition of employment, unfortunately.
Walked into the crossfire.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, I'm surprised he's even still showing up here. You better check your car, make sure it's not keyed as we get out of here.
He just tossed the package from the midway point of the sidewalk.
Well, yeah, I mean, that
he didn't even hit the porch.
It hit the package hit the doorbell.
It hit the doorbell, landed in the bushes, so...
Yeah, okay.
I better go out and get it.
All right. Well, let's make sure that's the right package.
Who's this from?
Okay.
Oh, it's from... it's the Double Platinum Club, which I don't know if you guys heard recently. There's a new member of the Double Platinum Club.
Really? There are more than...
Ken Mills over at the Podcast got himself... signed up.
So there are now two members of the club?
Now two hardcore KISS fans in the world.
Wow.
In the Double Platinum Club.
Wow.
So congratulations to Ken.
Huh. I wonder if he gets the same things we get, or if he gets I guess we'll find out.
It's an exclusive club.
Two. Yeah. All right. Well, we have a package here. Do you want to open it up? Are we guessing it is another lip balm?
I'm guessing because that's the stipulation of why Dickie Poncho couldn't go on vacation.
Mm. Well, if that you think he's going to follow your stipulations, the guy's pissed off.
Well, I guess we'll find out. He's still going to do his job, I think. He's dedicated
man, you're naive. You just got your head in the clouds, don't you?
Well, let's see here. Okay, got it open. And you're all in luck, everybody.
Oh, boy.
Continuing in that proud tradition that was started last week.
Oh, boy.
I didn't bring my glasses. This might be rough, but we've got...
Well, hand it to somebody who can see if there's other people in the room.
We've got... What is this? Is it a tube? No, what is it?
It's a tube.
I guess so. It's a tube of lip balm.
Yeah.
Part two in the series.
Mm.
It's the Spaceman Detroit Rock Berry lip balm, SPF 15 for those who are keeping stats.
So last week was the Star Child Hotter Than Grape,
which has taken the country by storm due to the aggressive advertising campaign started on this very podcast.
Right. Well, thankfully there's no, I don't see a DVD or anything in there. Is there anything?
Well, there's something here.
Was it a flash drive?
I can't read what it says. So
it
here.
Is. There is a flash drive. Damn it! I was hoping there wasn't more. Okay.
Why?
I don't know. Because, you know...
You just go against the grain on everything. If somebody likes something, you don't like it, and vice versa.
That's not it.
Yes, it is it.
Not in this case.
Why would you care if there's...
Because there's lightning in a bottle last week. I'm afraid this isn't going to be able to compete. I guess we'll just
When did you become such a cynic? Is it because of where you work?
No, probably 1996 or something. I don't know.
If you win the title, you have to defend the title.
Okay.
Right?
Well, I guess the advertising company who put the last one together and this one, I guess that applies to them.
It does. The geniuses behind...
Well, you don't think they had four ads ready to go? You think they scrambled to get another one?
No, I was told that there was scrambling involved. It's been confirmed.
I see an image already. All right.
Well, wait a minute. That's not the Spaceman. That's Tommy Thayer.
Well, that's Spaceman Tommy Thayer.
Wow.
Yeah, he's a Spaceman,
that's a cold shot on the day after Ace's birthday.
That's true. Oh, well.
Or since this is lip balm, it's a cold sore after Ace's birthday. So, Detroit Rock Berry, another name that makes no fucking sense. So
really
maybe this ad will tie everything together.
Ready to roll it?
I can't wait. Of course. Yeah.
All right.
Let's see what we got.
You want to know how I got these cherries?
Okay, I was
there's a lot happening.
Cracking up at the visuals. I missed the lyrics.
Oh, there's a lot going on.
Play it again. The microphone's down so we can hear.
What kind of chips are those?
Salt and vinegar.
Oh, that'll do it to you.
A lot of Star Child content.
Well, I mean,
it's interesting.
I think that's because he sings Detroit Rock City, so it's
That makes sense. Salt and vinegar?
That's what we got here,
That'll dry the lips up.
All right.
Yeah, oh shit.
Again?
I want to key in on the lyrics. So microphones down.
You gotta do the lips with Detroit Rock Baron.
You want to know how I got these chips?
Loop down.
Eggs, tomato, salt, and vinegar chips.
That will do it.
What's the first? You got to lube up with.
There's a lyric sheet.
You want to know how I got these chapped?
No. It says, very first lyric.
No, the first lyric here on the lyric sheet. You got to soothe your lips.
Oh, okay.
With Detroit Rock
Berry. The soothe gets a little lost, but it's well done.
And then lube up, lube down.
I like the Detroit hat on the blueberry.
Right. Because. In the tradition, that's sort of the thing.
Might become a new mascot for Detroit Tigers.
The Detroit Blueberry.
Why not?
The Detroit Dancing Blueberries.
Sky's the limit at this point.
Yeah.
I mean, what? Milwaukee has a sausage.
And yeah,
why not put a blueberry somewhere?
It's as good as anything for Detroit. Yeah. Although, given the demographic, perhaps a blackberry would be better, but, you know, who knows? It's not what we got here. That's a blue color scheme.
Yep. It's got to match. It's got to match the spaceman. So.
Well, so good stuff again. I'm liking the common theme of the descending animated characters on either side of the panel.
The descending animated berries or fruit,
Nothing. I don't expect anything to top the throbbing, rotating grapes. But this is good.
The Star Child graphics are the animation on the.
There's the little more production value.
Yeah,
In terms of, little more variety going on.
There is some throbbing for you. There's Paul's mouth throbbing.
It's true.
So don't worry, listeners. There's plenty of
throbbing. There's descending.
Fireworks.
There's berries. It's all there.
There's fireworks in there.
Yeah, there are fireworks in there.
And Paul's got a salt and vinegar chip.
Yep.
That's
his tongue. And then also on the sides here. Yep.
Damn good.
That'll chap your lips.
No complaints.
That's two in a row.
Well, we'll see if there's another one next week.
So there's a total of four, obviously.
Of four, correct.
This is exciting.
Since we have...
This is the best thing to happen since the Caribbean Cove series.
It's exciting,
Keep people engaged.
Yeah, every week there's something new. Well, hey, since this ad, I guess this ad campaign is technically... we'll post it on our social media. You could check it out right now, probably. If not right now, very soon, Monday, day of show. So check it out! So, Nick, the question everybody wants to know.
I better go turn on the random song generator. Pardon me.
Okay, fine.
Ah, yes.
Fired right up.
Purring like the proverbial kitten.
Mm. Okay. So... How does this interact with
the same way it did last week?
What was that?
I'm gonna put the
you put it on your lips and kiss something.
No, I'm put the software that came with it.
Oh,
the
right.
Advertising software. I'm loading it into there.
Oh, and then it just tells you.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. All right.
This one comes off
Ace Frehley.
It's called
Snowblind.
Okay. More shenanigans, accusations are coming our way, but
it's never
whatever. It works, you know.
More bullshit from us. Well,
not true.
So Snowblind, huh? Thinking about it right now. Ow. Stuck. My headphones are stuck. So Snowblind. This is Nick, I believe, was Ace's album and Creatures of the Night, the two you said every song is a Stone Cold Kiss classic in your eyes?
Yes.
Yes. So, I mean, we could start there. That's how you feel about this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I'm doing some research. in the book, Kiss Behind
there
the Mask.
There may not be any comments.
There isn't.
I don't
no.
think there is.
There's yeah. nothing?
Ace no,
there's
only talked about a couple songs.
There's Rip It Out and Fractured Mirror. Yeah. And that's it.
Oh.
What a letdown, by the way. That,
yeah.
That,
I don't know. Andy's a big fan of at least one of those tunes.
Yeah. But guess
just,
which one?
Just a... Just it's a letdown that in that book they didn't get something on it.
Yeah,
that's
strange. It's gotta be the least represented album, right?
I think so.
I would say so.
I think
yeah.
even Peter's has more commentary.
Wow, that's interesting.
It's unfortunate. Well, what track is this? I'm trying to remember. Out of what, 9 on there? Got to pull it up. I think there's 9
this
songs
one
on
is,
there.
This is in the middle somewhere, isn't it?
Let's go 4. It's 3 of 9.
Oh, 3.
Three
okay.
of 9. Track
yeah,
3.
Somewhere in there.
Yep. Okay. So again, 1978 solo albums, all 4 dudes. You know, Aces is widely regarded as the best by most people. Maybe Paul's. Can argue
the,
that one.
Those are the only two that can be.
They're the only two in the conversation.
Yeah, basically.
Gene and Peters are on a lower tier. But.
Well, I don't know.
What?
I've got an affinity for Peters. I would agree that they're on a lower tier, yes, but not as low as most people instinctively believe.
Well, there could be several tiers, I guess.
Yeah. You're right.
Doesn't
it's
have
on
to be
the
lower
very tier.
Bottom, but yeah. So track 3, Snowblind.
Track 3. Huh?
Yeah. Any thoughts?
I had the 8 track of this, and as we've talked about time and time again, the song order on those things was completely fucked up. I seem to remember this being on one of the second program 3 or 4. Didn't remember it being this early on in the.
What does
release.
Program mean in that world?
There are 4 programs on an 8-track, so 4 like channels that you could switch between, but
okay.
you couldn't really fast forward or rewind.
So it'd be like roughly 2 to 3 songs per.
Yeah, and then sometimes they'd fucking cut songs in half to accommodate it, so it'd like fade out in the middle, and then it. Would switch to programs and fade back in. It was really stupid.
That sucks.
That reminds me of something from my youth now.
Mm-hmm.
The only experience I had with an 8-track was the, it was a robot, like an educational toy that we had from the 70s called 2XL.
Yeah.
And it had an 8-track player, like its stomach had like a slot in it. And
right.
You put the 8-track in there. If I'm not mistaken, there were 4 buttons. That must have been how they did it, because they had the 4 programs, and if
right.
you when you got to a certain point, if you pressed the correct button, it took you to that particular program. I'm guessing
that makes
there
sense.
Must have been some. That must have been the way they did it. I never realized that.
But we didn't have any others to listen.
No,
to.
No, we didn't have any actual yeah. musical
right.
tracks.
It was just like I don't know, questions about like Mary Lou Retton.
Yeah.
It was like trivia
that's,
type of.
That's about what Nadia Comaneci.
Right, yeah. That type of stuff. Sort of like a Jeopardy style.
Yeah.
With
yeah.
different subjects.
Yeah,
and
so
stuff.
That's interesting right. that you bring up the programs. I never realized that. That kind of explains that, I think.
Yep. Well, anything special to talk about before we dive in here? I know this is Ace and Anton. It's probably about it.
Maybe
right?
Will, maybe Will Lee, maybe not. That's about all.
I think it's not maybe Will not. Lee on this one.
Okay,
yeah.
Just who is it?
Just Ace.
Wow. Okay.
Yep. Ace of Base, if you will.
Yep. Doing
the base
everything.
Of Ace coming at you.
Yep. This song, just off the top of my head, goes in a couple strange directions. So I think this is going to be fun.
That could, this
be,
could
fun.
Be fun. Yeah.
All right, you guys ready?
Yeah.
Hit it. Little percussion going on there. People love it when we talk about the percussion elements in these
yeah.
songs.
Ignore the guitar.
Especially that one dickhead on that, what was it?
That was on YouTube.
Yeah, right. What, for the Elder song? The,
yeah, Dark Light.
Yeah. This one's for you, Cocksmoke. cowbell sounds like, just your standard variety cowbell.
Yep. A
couple of formidable snare hits to kick the song off, huh?
Yep.
That's probably, that could be the longest we've let a song play before we started talking about it. Usually Nick's waving his arms around two or three seconds in.
Couldn't think of exactly what I would have wanted to say about it. It's got a bit of a, it's certainly got a mood to it. I don't know. I guess it's a dark kind of a mood.
It's kind of a heavy riff.
A little ominous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, Snowblind, do you gonna have the lyrics up?
Yes.
Do you think, is this song like the Black Sabbath counterpart, a tribute to the drug cocaine?
I would say yes.
Tim Raines' drug of choice.
Yeah. What I'm wondering more than that even is if certain people in the room are going to be okay with this song having the same title as another song that existed a couple years earlier.
That's interesting.
It has happened before.
Does that rub you the wrong way, Chris?
This could be upsetting.
Well, there's a difference between ripping off Black Sabbath and ripping off Loudness, okay? Let's make that differentiation right here and now.
Big difference there?
Yeah, I think so. Mm-hmm. I mean, listen to what I just said. I mean, how much bigger a difference could there be?
Right.
But I'm interested in digging into the lyrics. It's been a long time since I heard this one, so.
That's not the right button at all.
It's so hard to feel right here. When I'm traveling around and you fall behind.
You know, the production on Ace's solo album is pretty sophisticated if you think about it.
Yeah.
It's more sophisticated than the typical Kiss album.
Sure.
I mean,
there's a lot of echoing and delays being used.
Yeah, he's the spaceman, so I guess it makes a lot of sense that he can get away with using a lot of these sorts of effects on his voice and everything.
Yeah. Also, I think the drums sound better on Ace's solo album than any of the others.
Yeah. Maybe
that's most
totally
Kiss
true.
Albums too. Not all. But
I don't know about that. Well, again, you know, you're lower tier most Kiss albums,
right.
I guess technically you're right.
But, yeah.
You gotta hand it to Ace, and again, day after his 66th birthday that this came up, it's pretty cool. The man took his opportunity with the solo album and fucking ran with it, didn't
he?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Really fucking rose to the occasion.
And it really sounded like, if you go through, you know, autobiographies and stuff, it sounded like Gene and Paul had no hopes for Ace to do anything. Like, his solo album was going to be a humiliation.
I've talked about this before. Same with Peter. It was like, you know, those guys are starting to get some egos, and this is, I firmly believe that this was Gene Paul's attempt to fucking squash them, and it totally backfired.
Yeah.
Certainly in this case, and again, you know, Peter's album isn't well received, but in terms of the point of a solo album, and do something a little different, maybe, or more specifically, do something that's an expression of yourself, he rose to the occasion as well.
Yeah, when you put it that way, I think he did it maybe more than anybody else did.
Yeah. So far, so what's that? What was the lyric on that? He was yelling at the end.
He said, "It's so hard to feel right, baby, when I'm traveling around and you're far behind."
Meaning he's jacked up on coke and his lady friend isn't. Not a pleasant dynamic.
Not keeping up with him.
Nobody is having fun in that situation.
I don't know what exactly is being used, but it almost sounds like scissors.
It does sound like scissors.
It's got a scissory effect to it.
Is that one of those little eggs? Like the little
Or it might be one of the, I can't think of what
eggs.
It's called, but it's like a sort of a circular thing on a stick, and you kind of shake it or you kind of rotate it quickly.
I think it's that.
And it's got the little beads on it. I can't think of what that's called. Mm. It's almost sounding like that to me, but it sounds like scissors.
Could be.
He's cutting open his bag of coke.
Well, there you go.
Sharpening his razor blade.
I can't think of what they use, but on the Judas Priest British Steel classic albums, they were showing how they got the sound effects for Metal Gods, and it was like they were just taking like keys and just scratching them against something and turned it into the sound of like these huge robots marching through.
How weird.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's probably not keys, but it's like a common item that they were just like throwing against a piece of metal or something and recording it. So it could very well be scissors.
I had done a thing once. I was just kind of playing around recording something, and I wanted like a sweeping sound, kind of like what we're getting in the intro of the song, like that.
Yep.
And I wanted to get something like that. And I had this pair of corduroy pants from the 90s that had the really thick corduroy threads or whatever they're called. I just put the mic on it and kind of rubbed it with my hand to make the sweeping sound.
That came out nice.
You rub it in your groin area.
Well,
get some other sound effects going.
Well,
Brian Sherwood.
It's the ultimate legal high.
Rubbing your corduroy.
They FUBU corduroys by chance.
Yeah, so you can manipulate all kinds of stuff.
But it sounded good.
Yeah, it sounded good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Isn't it just an interesting, you know, it's especially if you have the capability to do something, you know, in, as they say, in post.
Yeah, those.
If you can generate a basic sound like that, pick it up decently in the microphone, you can manipulate it to be just about anything.
Those types of stories are really cool to hear. I'm having trouble thinking of them. Like, I remember there's a Queen. Oh, God, what song is it?
Lazing on a Sunday Afternoon.
Is it?
With the microphone in the bucket.
That's one where they get that tinny sound.
Yeah.
And then also, like, the little tapping. Isn't that just, like, tapping on a table with something?
I don't remember that part.
Yeah.
Are you talking about Seaside Rendezvous, perhaps?
Yep, I am. Okay. Yep, thanks. Yeah, I think there was something about that, though. You know, fingernails on a table or something like that.
That's pretty much what it sounds like.
Yeah, but just not...
Like a faux tap dance kind of a sound.
Yeah, just doing cool stuff with common items adds to a song. I don't know. I don't want to say...
Let's just say there's scissors going on this one. Why not?
Why not?
Yeah.
Love the scissors on
here. It's a little jarring, actually. Yeah. Like scissors, somebody... It's like has someone ever done that old trick to you where they'll grab a little piece of your hair in the back and a couple inches off they'll loudly clamp down the scissors?
That individual would be dead if they did to either me or Andy, I'm reckoning.
Pretending that they just cut your hair behind you.
Yeah, is this a common thing?
I think probably just one idiot at high school. I remember seeing do that to somebody, but
one shithead.
Pretty much. Yeah. But it's generating an effect when you're listening to it in the headphones where it's a little jarring. Someone might be coming after you.
The old space reference.
Yeah, gotta have it.
gotta have it.
And people get mad at Tommy.
Right.
Oh, well.
Well, they get mad at him for their other reasons, which are baseless. But, you know, what are you going to do?
So I can't say a thing. I don't want to sing. Need a familiar face.
Now, this
think I'm lost.
This sounds like it has almost... This might not have anything to do with drugs.
You don't think so?
I don't know. It's not or pr- like dominant theme to me is just he's on the road and he's burned out. I don't want to sing like, oh, I got to go, you know, I got to go up on stage again tonight. I don't want to sing.
But what would Snowblind mean otherwise?
Is that the only, I mean, Snowblind, I guess, is what, like a whiteout condition, right? Outside, like a blizzard. And then, of course, then... There's the Black Sabbath one.
Yeah. Well, but it was also the 70s when people were just infatuated with cocaine, the disco era, all that stuff.
But I mean, could it possibly be that this song's about him being on the road, burned out, lonely and there's a snowstorm.
Where he's literal snowballing?
Yeah, and he can't do anything about it.
I guess anything's possible.
He's stuck in his room or something.
I would say it's probably he's burned out and you're right about everything else. He's on the road and he's also doing a lot of drugs and it's both.
Well, I guess it could be that, but I don't know. I'm not from maybe the rest of the lyrics.
Maybe he's out of cocaine and he's coming down from the drug.
I don't know.
Also not a pleasant scenario. Looking out my window, sometimes I wonder,
am I ever gonna get to where I'm gonna go home? That's a weird phrase. Weird phrasing there. Am I ever gonna get to where I'm gonna go home?
It's weird, but it flows just right.
It's nice, but it's just strange. Am I ever gonna get to where I'm gonna go home? Not to where I'm gonna go, but to where I'm gonna go home. I don't know. Strange.
You don't think it's just go ho?
Kind of, but I don't know. I thought I heard a mmm in there, and it does say home.
Like, well, maybe he wants to go home and work his garden with the hoe.
Could be that.
You never know.
Go home to his hoe.
That's, there
he
you go.
He misses his garden. He wants to put his hands in the soil.
Nothing to do. Okay.
He wants to put his hands in the
soil.
He wants
to get back to real life.
There you
life.
Go.
Hands in
he wants
the soil.
To put his hands on Nick's corduroys. That's what he wants to do.
Well, Nick's soiled corduroys.
Yeah, soiled.
He read Peter's book. It's not... Not too far off from being a possibility.
Wouldn't be the first time is what was implied in that book.
Maybe tomorrow, maybe next summer. Girl, I just don't know. Cause I'm so blind, I can't see a thing. I'm so blind.
Weird.
What's that? Sounds like the bullshit that was going on at the beginning of Radioactive on Gene Smith.
What the hell are you doing?
some weird Tom. It sounds electronic, like an electronic Tom.
Those roto pads or
kind of sound effect. I don't know.
Well, Ace had the state of the art studio in his basement.
He did.
Then.
Yeah,
and he still loves computers.
Where he and Peter literally got off on what they were creating.
Yeah.
Not figuratively, literally.
Literally.
Talk about soiled corduroys. A lot of that going on. We don't need
up,
that
down
in there,
and back,
you know?
And forth,
what
yeah.
are they doing with that? That doesn't make any sense.
There's a lot of
it's unnecessary.
A lot of stuff in here just seems to be there just to kind of be a little bit off-putting, perhaps
experimental.
Little, yeah, just something to kind of
unique,
like they say it now. Okay, this is gonna sound very pretentious, but I just read this somewhere, so I'm
oh
not.
Oh boy,
it's like their version of the Pierre sound effect,
like
sprinkled throughout,
like a Stanley Kubrick film. They say that he would do things like just to throw people off.
Uh huh.
Like he would have a shot where the set had, you know, certain props in certain places,
mm-hmm.
and then it would cut to somewhere else, and when it cut back to the same shot, things would be moved around.
Oh,
it's like intentional continuity error.
Yeah, like disorientation or something like that.
Are you sure he didn't just make that up because he messed up? Oh, yeah, I did that on purpose. Because
people were messing with him when he wasn't looking.
Or that. Yeah, this guy's a dick. Let's ruin this.
Let's see him talk his way out of this one.
Yeah. Mess is shot up. Artsy dick. Ruin your movie.
Yeah. a man on fire right there.
Yeah. That's high octane soloing.
Reminds me of the Ozone solo where it just kept going.
Yeah.
And somehow he kept going at that pace.
Yeah. Those long solos are not, it's not easy to keep your stamina up, you know. Not everybody is Michelangelo Baddio. You just fucking do that bullshit endlessly.
Right.
Plus, it was an up-tempo backing sort of rhythm going on there. So.
Yeah, that was cool. I like that.
That was a great part. I forgot about that part. It sounded good. Mm-hmm. Fits in, too. It's different, but it doesn't seem like it's just tossed in.
It's not
it
like
flows
a cut.
Into, yeah.
It's not cut and paste from another song or anything. Like, it works with what's going on. Adds to the
ushered
song.
In by some more formidable snare hits by your boy, Anton Fig.
What's not to like?
Have you ever met Anton Fig?
No.
Would you like to meet Anton Fig?
Yeah, absolutely. I gave a nod to him. I tried to, as we were leaving the Ed Sullivan Theater when I saw Letterman. I don't remember her name, but the guitarist, the black woman.
Felicia Collins.
Okay, I tipped my hat to the band and made eye contact with her, and she kind of, as they were playing, she kind of gave me a nod.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she did.
Because nobody was like, you know,
wanted to get in them corduroys.
I was like clapping toward the band because like the band was there. Think of who's in that band.
It's a kick-ass.
Yeah,
was a kick-ass.
And it's just kind of like. People are getting up and walking out, and the band's playing. I'm like, holy cow. And then Alan Coulter is on the side of the stage doing some repair work on the...
on what?
On some of the announcements.
Oh, like changing?
They had him go through and do some... I don't know if it was repair necessarily or if it was just kind of... it might have been for the segues between commercial breaks.
Right, yeah.
That might be actually where the music is from. I don't know. It's been a few years, but
right.
Yeah. But anyway, it's that's as close as I came. I got to watch him play. I was like third row.
That's pretty cool. I didn't realize that went down.
Lee.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I kind of knew you'd went, but I forgot about it.
Do you remember any of the songs they played while you were there at that show?
I don't, but I have the episode recorded, so I could go back and check it out.
Who were the guests?
Is the guy from Lost? I don't like the main guy. I forget his
Matthew
name.
Matthew Fox, I think.
Probably, I don't know. And
the Buzzed
Party
Head.
Of Five.
Yeah, the Buzzed
guy.
Head and Zach Brown Band.
Oh, okay.
Who are like very like vocally that harmony and everything like that's like sounded perfect.
Really?
Yeah, pretty
got their
pretty
shit
impressive.
Together, huh?
Never even heard of them before that.
Wow,
pretty impressive.
Yeah, they're good.
Sound like shit's falling down.
It's Fibber McGee's closet over here.
Who's that?
That's an old reference.
Well, I'm sure.
Old radio show where that was one of the
here
gimmicks.
Here we go.
Old radio
it's been
show
a long
where,
time since we talked about
well,
old
you guys,
radio
you guys know
shows.
I'm a big fan of old radio.
God. Nick brings the old radio listeners to Pot of Thunder. So
well, it's, yeah. it
we
was
have
just
to indulge once
all
in a
it,
while.
All it was a gimmick where the guy would be looking for something. Maybe it's in the closet. You hear the door opening, and then you just hear stuff falling
right.
for the next 10 seconds.
And I'm sure there was inevitably there's a cat scream in there, that old sound.
Sounds of urban chaos.
Yeah,
the
a broken bottle.
White smoking's happening.
Guns, yeah.
The Model T Ford.
How great is that, by the way? Just that they threw that in there.
Just to go back to that, you mean?
Yeah, just the drums, the way they're overdubbing this stuff.
Oh yeah,
that they went back and overdubbed some drum
random
fills.
Stuff. Yeah,
it's just they really really did a lot of cool stuff on this.
Yeah, they did.
Experiment.
Why not overdub some drums?
Yeah, and it wasn't
says you can't.
Wasn't to the point where it was overdone. It was like perfect.
Yeah,
that's right. It with. Kind of like that middle section didn't sound like it was just shoehorned in there. It blended in pretty nicely.
Yeah, it's almost like if you had a percussion player, that's almost like what they might be playing, but it's with just like a regular drum set on. It's like a second drum set on top of the regular beat.
Yeah, and
it's not like, what did we call them? Adjust a touch of what? I can't remember.
A touch of congas?
Yeah, there you go. Instead of adding a touch of congas, it was, you know... It's like actual toms. So there you go.
Moving around, I get in trouble.
Boy, he gets in trouble.
Gets in trouble.
There's moving around, I get in trouble.
There are stories about that, him being in hotel rooms.
Yeah, he gets bored.
Firing bow and arrows in hotels.
Good Lord. Feeling low and out of his mind, huh?
I don't know. I don't know the word snowblind like all in all its meanings.
Sure.
All I know is the Black Sabbath song, basically, but... I don't know. I'm not detecting anything that's explicitly pointing to drug.
No.
Use.
Yeah, I'm not really either.
No, definitely
lyrics.
Not. It's just I don't know what just else he's talking about.
He's burned out and
yeah, I guess so.
Being on the road.
Go ahead.
I have a hard time believing he's literally saying there's a blizzard outside and I'm stuck. But you never know.
Yeah, I don't know what
could happen.
I don't know what the snowblind actually would refer to here.
Yeah.
I don't really get it, but. It works.
It's two cool words or whatever. I don't know.
So.
Sounds cool.
And I knew this song before I knew the Black Sabbath song. So
there you go.
So I found that interesting when I heard
the
Sabbath
song. There's no question what it's about.
Yeah,
so.
I mean, the word cocaine is in it.
He yells
times, so.
It out three
yeah.
or four times.
I thought he yelled Tim Raines.
Yeah.
Cocaine.
That's who he saw in the audience. In the VIP section.
Yeah, he's letting him through. Let him through the velvet rope.
Tim Raines. Triple A star. About to be brought up to the majors.
Yeah.
Tim Raines.
I think we need to record that song with a Tim Raines. Shout out in the middle. Big echo on it. All right.
No, this is probably not. My mind's just kind of scrambling to think of something that I've heard about Ace that could fit into the snowblind thing. Mm-hmm. The only thing that comes to mind
is that he's honked up cocaine like a maniac. Maybe that
there,
could factor into it.
There's that, but there's the story about I forget exactly what photo shoot or whatever it was from when he. Oh no, it wasn't a photo shoot. I think it was after a show. He had the silver face paint on, never ended up taking it off, and passed out for the whole night with it on. Woke up, and I think his eyes, like, there was some sort of metallic dust in it.
Oh, jeez.
And his eyes were, like, he couldn't even open them, I guess. He had to get someone to help him and flush his eyes out and everything.
So that's some toxic stuff back
yeah,
then.
And I'm thinking that must be why he, like, you see on the... Well, not necessarily on this album. It doesn't look like he has the blue mascara or what? Not
right.
Not mascara, whatever it is. The
eyeshadow. Right.
Like on Dynasty. Mm. I don't know. That's the only piece of Kiss lore I can think of that might have to do with Ace not being able to see. I mean, Shock Me is about him actually getting shocked.
You're actually onto something by saying that because it seems like that's what he kind of did. He would... take a situation,
so,
something that happened to him, and then write sort of a fictional...
At least with Shock Me, yeah.
Yeah.
But I can't think of any other ones offhand, except for Rock Soldiers talking about being in the car wreck.
Right.
Yeah.
There you go.
What's that line?
DeLorean's automobile. That one?
What's, if the devil wants to play his card game now, then Chris's favorite lyric of all time?
Yeah.
He's going to have to play without an ace in his... Yuck.
Terrible.
You don't like that?
Why it's not? Just clumsily executed.
I always like how he said deck, though.
Deck.
It's like...
it might have to be a wild card episode. It'd be worthwhile to devote an episode to that.
Yeah.
That's a great one.
All right. Let's continue here.
Yeah. creating a mood there by slowing it down.
Yeah, and that fucking just droning guitar going on. That was really good. And I forgot about that part, too.
The way
That's a top tune on this album, no question.
The way they kept the vocals kind of echoing at the end, it fit in very well.
Yeah.
With that little sound collage we got at the end.
They must have had a good time mixing this one up and doing their thing with it. That was good. I forgot. I hadn't heard that song in a long time. That's a top cut on this album. No doubt about it. I'll vote right now. I'll just say hallelujah. Why not? Hallelujah! I mean, that's... I can't think of anything not to like. Maybe those kind of weird sound effects didn't really need to be in there, but that, you know, that's really... would be grasping at something to find fault with in this one. Really, really good tune. Resounding hallelujah for me.
Damn. Nick?
Well, you know. It's on Ace's solo album, so it's awesome.
Automatic.
By default.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
I forgot that you had two albums that fit that criteria.
Yeah.
The Fractured Mirror episode is going to be a good one. It's another one people are looking forward to, as well they should.
I hope it's not in the random song generator.
Oh, come on. Let's face it. They're all in there.
Okay.
So
that's the problem. We have faced it.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I think I can't complain about anything. Mm-hmm. I think the fact that I can't really put my finger on what it's about exactly isn't such a bad thing.
Sure.
I don't mind that.
Yeah.
Sound effects, I think, were done tastefully. I don't think there was anything where I'm like, yeah, that was kind of dumb, unnecessary.
Right.
I think it was all... it's a really good example of using effects and still maintaining the integrity of the song. It doesn't take away from that.
Yeah. I mean, Chris talked about Radioactive before, where it was a little bit over the top for his liking. Am I right?
Yeah, I didn't care for that at all.
Well, that beginning is a little crazy, yeah.
Yeah,
stupid is the word I would use to describe it. But
so, yeah, I mean, and vocal performance, everything on this album. Ace is supposed to not have a good voice, if you ask certain people.
I mean,
his vocal delivery is perfect on this album for what he's doing. Yeah. Everything on this album came together, and it works. So it all clicks.
Pretty much, yeah.
Ace is never going to sing an opera or anything, but for
doesn't
what
need
he's
to.
No, exactly.
We don't want him to.
Right. So I mean, when people criticize Ace's voice, I mean, that's what do you tell me that he's not good on his solo album? I mean, you'd be crazy. I mean,
you could say he on his newer stuff, he over enunciates a little.
Sure, that's a whole other conversation.
Yeah, that's whole other
new, time. You mean like his recent stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, like the covers album. There's some stuff on it where
he's
it's
doing
a little
over the top acisms.
Again, he's 64 or 5 when he recorded that, and the man is not really taking care of himself. But yeah, I mean, it's rock and roll, you know.
Right.
He's not going to sing like Jolin Turner. He's not going to play like Yngwie Malmsteen, and nor would we want him to.
No.
It's from the gut where the rock and roll should come from, or lower, as Gene advocates.
Yep. All right, so my turn. Let's not build any fake suspense.
Like, yeah, let's not.
Keep getting bullshit from people. Like, I'm trying to go against the grain on purpose to start controversy or something. Not the case. Hallelujah, hands down. One of the best. So many good ones on Ace's solo album. Snowblind's one of the best. I feel like a broken record saying this, but, you know, anytime when a song can go in a couple different directions and it all ties together nicely, it's always exciting. Always cool. So this is one of those. This isn't like, you know, the bad, paint by numbers kind of thing that sometimes bands fall into where you're writing the same song over and over and over. It's kind of fresh and cool and still sounds cool.
Isn't Ozone the other one that goes in a lot of different directions?
Yeah.
The transitions in this one are a lot smoother than
definitely,
that one.
Sure.
Those are just like suddenly turning on a dime, which in and of itself is pretty cool, but This one just kind of flows a lot better. So. Yeah.
Well, hey.
Oh, what do you know?
Yeah, it's been a while we've gone to the next round, right?
Yeah, since we've all been on the same page.
Well, we've also gotten a lot of crap recently.
Sure. Yeah.
Thought we got a lot of that out of the way at the beginning, but just goes to show how much crap is in the Kiss discography.
Well, I mean, we put out so many albums. There's got to be crap, right?
Well, yeah. We would hope there would be less, but it's not.
Well, hey, it's time to vote. Round two.
All right, Hammond! I got a question for you.
It's been forever since we did this. Yeah. Jesus.
You know, on Record Store Day.
Oh, I was just going to bring that up. You go ahead.
Now, Nick was talking to the guy who runs this record store that's been in business forever. And when Kiss played in Hammond, which is what we're listening to right now in 1974, Nick asked the dude about it because it was like, you could buy tickets on the, like you could see the old flyer online for that show.
And it's
buy tickets at S&J Stereo.
And I have to give credit to Kelly Lincoln. He gave me a laminated copy of that ad.
Did he really?
For that show, yeah.
Wow.
Have it hanging up in the basement.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, so that's why I brought it up because I was just looking at that and it said, Kiss and Rush,
right,
in Hammond in 1974, I think it was.
Over at the Civic Center?
No, man, it was Parthenon.
Oh,
smaller
right.
Smaller theater.
Damn. Basically the Family Dollar, but it's not there. That's what's there now, I think.
Over at the Family Dollar.
Yeah.
Right there in Calumet?
On Holman.
Just across the street.
Toby's?
Across the street from where,
Chris
just played a show for his birthday gig.
Oh, over there.
Right
there,
across the street. See, Chris jammed on one side of the street. Kiss was on the other.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
Turned out Rush didn't actually make it to that show.
Really?
For all the Kiss trivia completists out there, we have from a pretty reliable source, Rush did not actually make it to that particular show. I don't remember the date, but... Yeah. If anybody's that curious about it, I can send them a picture of the ad.
Yeah, he said, if anyone ever tells you they saw Rush that day, what is it? They're having some kind of flashback.
Yeah, I think he wanted to say something else, but there was a child
around. Yeah, say they're full of shit, basically. But yeah.
So who warmed up for him then? History's End.
I forget it. It was a local band.
He
but
said
I
it was a
name.
Local band. Yeah,
History's End.
They were still around. You could fill in the blanks with your local bar
the
band.
The shittiest band in your region.
Right.
Just fill them in.
That plays every event every summer.
And probably plays a song accidentally that is one of the headliner songs.
Right.
Yeah, or not accidentally because that's the kind of cocks they are.
That would be a hilarious, I think, situation to have go on.
Yeah.
A scenario to have an obnoxious local covers band. Open for somebody at a festival and play the song. Play a song by the band that's actually headlining.
They might have actually done that when these chodes opened for the Black Crows at the
all right, let's
Festival of Lakes.
Let's open with She Talks to Angels.
Yeah, or Hard to Hand. And go down the list of any Black Crows hits. I wouldn't be surprised.
Let's do Remedy.
It was ridiculous.
No, I don't doubt it.
Let's do an encore before the Black Crows and do Remedy.
Yeah.
Wouldn't doubt it.
Stupid. It was ridiculous.
Bad booking.
Terrible.
All right. We're going through this thing. We're going to have to start it over again.
Oh, boy.
I need a longer loop.
My arms are tired, says Peter. I need a sandwich.
Yep.
Need to carb up before I can play this more.
Put it right on the snare drum. That's why he's playing the toms. He's got a sandwich on the
snare.
He's
got it in, he's got it in a stick bag. It's got a sandwich bag hanging off the other floor, Tom.
Maybe that was the percussion instrument we were hearing in the song. He was playing the sandwich. Sandwich after sandwich on that recording.
So anyway, the question Paul Stanley wants to know. Is Snowblind a Stone Cold Kiss classic as voted by the three rock and roll boners in this room? Andy, Nick, and Chris, in that order. Has to be unanimous to be a classic. And it has to get a good, and a real good. Are your votes in, gentlemen?
Mine's in.
Mine is in.
Mine is in.
And I'm looking at these elf cards. These are weird.
You have those today? You brought them
They're
with
so
you?
They're so
weird. Is it a new pack or the
no,
same
this
ones?
This is the same one that we had on the trip.
Yeah.
Elf was strange, huh?
Well, whoever's even stranger was whoever wrote these things.
That's
what I mean. The content.
There's a baseball card. It's Booyah Baseball. Nice pun there.
Terrible. All right, let's vote this. And we could talk elf as long as we want.
I think we did as much as we want already.
Yeah, we're done. All right. Good.
Good.
Real good.
Damn.
Dust off those sound effects.
I don't even think we have it anymore.
No, so come on. It's got to be in there.
It's gone.
Maybe if you named the files something you could recognize instead of random fucking numbers.
Well, this took you
shit.
By surprise, didn't it? You weren't ready.
I had no idea.
Yeah!
It's properly named. What the fuck is the problem?
I can't read. I'm tired.
Andy's snowblind.
Idiot. Yeah, exactly.
Found it. I found it so fast. I was just acting. Well, there you have it. Stone Cold Kiss Classic.
Yeah, why not?
And if you disagree before we jump to the next segment.
Something wrong with you if you disagree.
I'll be surprised if there's any dissent. Maybe there might be some debate about SKKK. But
nah, you're snow deaf if you don't think this is
good one.
SKKK.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, you must be having some kind of flashback if you don't think this is a classic.
That's just the fucking way it is.
That reminds me of another story.
Tell it, please.
We're a present company. Well, not this present company, but at the time, the present company altered the way that a story was being told.
Mm-hmm. What, because there was
because
someone
certain,
in the room.
Some, a certain person was there.
Child or
so
woman
things
or
had
something.
To, things had to be altered from, you know, kind of what you figured was going to be said.
Was it child or was it woman?
It was woman.
Okay,
it was. It was an older gentleman he was telling, I forget exactly if it was like a food, something. He was comparing it to, he was going to go down the road of a sexual experience, I'm sure.
Sure.
It's so good, it's like, and then he looks over and my wife, girlfriend at the time, mm-hmm. was standing there with me and he goes, like hugging a teddy bear.
I wonder what he was going to say.
I'm sure it's probably, it was going to be something basic. It's like intercourse, most likely he was going to say something like that. But
yeah. But yeah, hugging a teddy bear.
he hesitated. At the moment he hesitated, it was like, okay, everybody knows you're trying to think of a way to censor yourself.
Yeah, and scrambling.
Hugging a teddy bear.
Landing on hugging a teddy bear. It's pretty good. Well, hey, guess what time it is? There's time for more stuff.
What?
All right. Another Yardo questions coming your way. Today.
Somebody playing the sandwich in this sound clip?
It's outdoor storm.
Someone underrated was, percussion instrument.
The Foley artist was
What kind of bread would you recommend to get that effect? Is that Italian or...
The Foley artist was hitting a piece of sheet metal with Italian herbs and cheese.
Some herb bread?
Yeah, exactly.
Herb bread was the engineer.
Herb bread.
Banquet basket of herb bread.
That's what's making the thunderstorm. I just dropped an unused, at the end of the night, unused basket of herb bread onto a metal sheet.
Into the cauldron of the hot tub and some weird chemical reaction going on.
All right, well, this week's Yardo questions brought to you by listener Jeff Gauss.
Okay.
Ready? Here
Thank
we go.
Thank you for participating, Jeff.
Thank you, Jeff. His little avatar is a Motorhead logo, so there you go.
All right.
Quality individual.
Yep. All right, here we go. Favorite Ace replacement, meaning
other guitar
not
player?
Ace, who's your favorite Kiss guitar player?
Bruce.
Yeah, I'd have to go Bruce Kulick.
Unanimous Brucing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a run by Brucing.
All right, well, that was an easy one.
Yeah, I mean, Mark St. John isn't even on the list, but, and, you know, Vinny and Tommy have their appeal, but, you know, Bruce came into his own and just really killed it on Revenge, and he was pretty, he had some good stuff going on in Hot in the Shade as well, so Bruce for me. Plus, we've seen him at a couple Kiss expos. Hell of a nice guy.
Yeah, seems like a really cool dude. Question two. Favorite Kiss tune you were unfamiliar with before Pot of Thunder?
Well, you guys know this one. For me, I talked about this.
Fits Like a Glove.
I don't remember. I literally don't remember.
On the Eighth Day.
Oh, God.
Right. Which I don't
absolutely
understand.
Absolutely took my world by storm.
Oh,
really?
And is still just a favorite of mine.
I don't get it, man.
It's great, man.
Yeah?
Yeah, don't be a fool.
I'm glad I don't have to ride around in a car with you as much as I used to when we were teenagers.
Yeah. It would have been. It would good. Be on. That's for sure. It would
be on a loop all the way to Subway and back.
Chris, what's yours?
I would have to say it's a toss-up between Easy As It Seems and It's All Right from Paul's solo album.
Yeah.
Two classics.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, It's All Right is what a great rocker.
One of the best.
What about you, Andy? Let's throw you into this. I'm curious.
Unfamiliar with is hard.
Yeah, because you're a Kiss completist, aren't you?
It's not like I don't consider myself on the level of any of the other podcast hosts or historians or whatever. But, I mean, I don't know how many of the songs we've listened to that I didn't at least know a little, which makes it hard to answer.
But is there one that maybe you knew a little bit, and as we were listening to it, it was appealing to you way more than it ever has before?
Well, yeah, we kind of talked about this before. I would just say as an album, Peter Criss's album, but just his solo songs in general. I don't know. Maybe...
I remember when we did Hooked on Rock and Roll. I forget what your quote was, but it was just the song Rules.
Yeah.
You broke into the middle of
it.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
There you go.
So, maybe Hooked on Rock and
with
Roll.
With the Vic Trolla needle
that's a
and
good,
all that
that's
stuff.
A good choice.
Yeah. So, that's my choice. So that's one that I wouldn't say I listened to a great deal before we did Pot of Thunder.
Question there.
Yep. Question three. Have you heard about Rock and Pod Expo in Nashville? Big fan, and then the /M/ to make the little devil horn
metal.
Yes. Yeah. So there you go. Have you heard about Rock and Pod Expo in Nashville?
Yes.
I've heard of it.
What the hell is that all about?
It's just a bunch of
rock
music. Yeah. Podcasters getting together for some, I don't know, networking event. I don't know what kind of functions or entertainment would be going on. But
I want to say they're making a pretty, I don't know that as far as like anybody being cemented in there, but I thought they were working on getting like some legit, like pretty decent name people to be there too.
Really?
Like there's going to be all these.
Well, we're not going to be there.
Well,
so
no.
I don't know how
that
legit.
That list is incomplete.
That frees up some room for them to find people.
Yeah, I wish we could make it, but it's just, I don't know. Maybe if they have it every year, we can plan ahead for the following year, because that'll be right around the time this podcast is grinding to a halt. So it might be a good time to, might be a good swan song.
Yeah.
Go in there, get our dicks out, and wreck the place and cause all sorts of mayhem. And that'll be it.
Yeah. I don't.
The proverbial mic drop on this podcast.
There you go. I guess I should look it up and find out more about it, but I don't really
I haven't looked it up in a while, so I'm not up to date on it, but it seems like it's going to be a pretty big shindig.
Big shindig, but what's beneficial about it? I'm not saying it's not. I'm just curious.
I guess
networking.
Yeah. So. Getting to meet people that you're familiar with online, probably.
I guess my question would be, would there be any like podcast fans or listeners, or is it just a bunch of guys who do podcasts?
Yeah. Can you build an audience, or are you just like, listen to mine, I'll listen to yours?
Yeah, it's kind of like how a music scene is, you know? You come to my gigs, I'll go to yours.
Sure.
You know,
I'm not
saying
it's bad, yeah.
Get a pretty good scene going. It'd be cool to go. I just can't work it in, I don't think. I've never been to Nashville, so.
fun place. A lot of partying. I know you guys love to party. Fit right in. Be a good time. Maybe next year. Well, thanks again, Jeff. Good questions.
Yeah.
That was this week's Yardo questions. If you have three questions you want to ask, go ahead and find us on Facebook or Twitter. There's instructions there. Follow those, and we'll feature your questions at random at some point. This show is all about being at random, isn't it? All right.
Despite the accusations of shenanigans, that's how it goes.
Yeah.
If you don't believe us, well, whatever.
Go fly
you
a
probably
kite.
Think the Earth is flat. One of those weirdos that's come out of the woodwork of late.
Flat earthers.
And Shaquille O'Neal's going to make fun of you.
Is that what happened?
He was joking.
So he... Oh, he said he believed
that too, and then they were like, really, really? He's like, no, you idiot.
Oh, okay. Got it. Well, he's one of Chris's favorites.
He's a good guy. Master of panic alone. Yeah. Or makes him okay in my book.
What was that story he was commenting on? Was it his coach or was it his former coach?
It was his former coach, Stan Van Gundy, and now coaches the Pistons who suck.
Oh, yeah. You're not a fan of Van Gundy at all, huh?
Not really. No. He's exactly what Shaq described him as. He's just decidedly mediocre.
Sucks. Yeah. So what did that guy said something about Shaq, and then his comments back? Among other things, he said he's a master of panic.
Yeah.
What a great thing to say, like, in the moment.
Exactly.
Like, hey, this guy said this about you a minute ago. He's a master of panic. Yeah, like, just have that at the
throw
ready.
That out there. Yeah. It just goes to show what a sharp guy. You wouldn't think he is by his mannerisms, but and the way he played people about people thought he actually believed the Earth was flat. I mean, you know, right. The guy's in control.
Yeah. Well, I think that's going to do it, right?
That should do it.
That will do
Let's
it.
Wrap it up. Happy 66th to the spaceman.
Yeah, happy birthday, Ace.
Big fans here.
I guess we had a classic for his birthday, so how about that?
For sure.
That was nice. Well, hey, you're invited to the podcast event of the week next Monday when episode, 205 of Pot of Thunder. It is getting up there, isn't it?
Staggering to the finish line.
Yeah. Well, hey, check it out. And also, if you want to see the... video advertisement for Detroit Rock Berry. Check us out on Facebook or Twitter, yeah. Instagram. It'll be on all three.
Don't miss that.
There you go. And feel free to go back and
don't be a fool.
Yeah, don't be a fool. And you could relive the magic of Hotter Than Grape.
Yeah, these things, they'll each take up, what, about 15 seconds of your time?
Yeah, 15
seconds. It's time well spent, believe me. Get it going.
I'm ready. I'm watching you. I don't know what you're doing. You're probably
What about Let's Get It Going? Did you not understand?
Well, I think you're doing something. But
I'm going to be on this phone until the Lions make the pick. So get used to it.
So roll it. Okay. Let's roll it.